Matthew was raising important questions, and now he's not there for me to point. Anyone know why Matthew didn't come to you? Had a theological crisis and left the school Tuesday night. Still not here. I want him to be here because we had this thing going with it. In any event, you will all have to catch back up. I'll text him. Had a theological issue here.
What was it?
Matthew raised the issue of what is the utility or the effect, and by implication the occupancy of prayer. When you pray for some bad thing to not happen, and then it happens just the same, you can have somebody that's sick and you pray for them and they don't get better. And then we say, well, you know, it was God's will. But then we pray for them, they do get better, and we say, what a great God we serve. You know, we usually don't say, oh, what a lousy God we serve when they don't get better. So he was asking, what the heck? What does that mean for, I assume, thinking rationally about our theological or theism position? And then I talked about the great controversy model, where there's this notion of you can't really have love if it's not based on freedom. If you're forcing somebody, you take them by force, and then you just isolate them until they finally have some sort of affection for you by default because you're their source of food and water. That doesn't add up to love. So if God created the universe to be based on love, then that would necessarily, at least with the logic that we're stuck with in the way that the universe happens to be, whatever love is, it couldn't be that unless the universe was based on freedom. And freedom is as hard an issue to unpack as God, existence / nature of God, and of love. I mean, freedom is, if you give something such absolute freedom, then it doesn't have form. There wouldn't be a manifestation of us if we were completely free. If I had no physical boundaries where I stop and start, or even if that's a fuzzy notion, and there's lots of ways to describe it, but if there's no that's not me, this is me, and there's membranes, and I know where I start and end, then it would be very difficult to have a concept of me as a discrete entity to then have a relationship. Or to even talk or think about, I suppose we could each be constructed non-personally, like truth, justice, fatigue, beauty, intelligence. You could have all these, but that's not personified. So there wouldn't be a person, a thinking, creative entity there. So when we do business with Genesis 1 and with John 1, it's easy to take for granted all that it means or could mean or necessarily can't not mean if you say that God created some sort of an entity in some way after God's own image. There must be something about that's ontological. Like, one of the things about God, at least in theory, that must be true to some degree about us is that we exist instead of not existing. If we think about SpongeBob SquarePants, there's a difference ontologically between SpongeBob and this Bob. You know? There's, I mean, at least as far as I can tell, that, you know, I can move about and have my being in a corporeal sense, and SpongeBob is a cartoon. And we can make up a character, Captain Nemo from, you know, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. I choose that one on purpose in this discussion because Nemo is the Latin for no one, for nobody. And Captain Nemo is nobody, along with every other character in Jules Verne's novel. You can look at the characters on Grey's Anatomy or something like that, Game of Thrones, whatever TV thing or whatever movie. What's this one that just came a second one out that's in the theater about a mafia assassin, John Wick. There is no John Wick. You know, but we engage with this character, with this caricature, but there isn't a person you can go see that has that car and those weapons and that dog and the whole thing. It's just not, there's no one there. Yes. Okay, thank you. That is so interesting. He came up on us, didn't he? He says, forget that, man. Do my art or whatever. I've had it with philosophy. Indeed. It's given up. Just when we were going to fix the whole God thing for him. Oh well. So there's a sense in which I have existence and you have existence that's different than some notions that have been created. Now, if I write a novel, I can come up with a character. Can even be a character that has characteristics that I've taken from people like you and me, or I can make them up completely. Like there's never been a person really quite like that person, but you can't go find them. You can only think about them and read about them. You can't go shake their hand or go to the Sherpa kitchen and have lunch with them. You can't have them. But my son and my daughter, those are real people. You can find them and shake their hand and go have lunch. And they have thoughts and capabilities and they can own things and wear things and the whole bit. So the difference between one kind of a product, one kind of a creature coming from me and another is... There's this huge ontological difference. But it gets kind of tricky if I start making sentient robots in my garage or in my workshop. If I start doing that, you know, like the Brent Spiner character on Star Trek Next Generation, Data, if I can make a positronic brain like they posit in that sci-fi series, and there's something that I can put an emotion chip in, and this is an entity that appears to make complex moral decisions and is extended in space and very strong, wears clothes, can get a job, very capable of a lot of things. We're going to make things like that. I mean, we're closing in on that. That's not going to seem strange to you very long. I know Siri can't quite tell what I want her to do when I tell her to do things. And she seems better at hearing other people's voices than mine sometimes, even when I don't even want things done. But the point is, we're into it, and it's just going to get way, 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 way better. I mean, pretty soon, we're going to have AI functioning in the place where Siri is supposed to be functioning is based on Watson, on IBM's Watson. And when that happens, if that happened tomorrow, it would, if the voice stayed modulated the same, if Siri's voice stayed modulated the same, but while we slept, they gave that function instead of to Apple's computer, Apple servers, they gave it to Watson. You'd know it tomorrow. It would scare you if they did that. If all of a sudden, without sort of ramping up to it, one sad little release with a step backward in one release and then two steps forward in the next software update, if they hooked it up to Watson, it would scare the daylights out of you, because all of a sudden, it would be suggesting things to you that you didn't even ask for. I mean, Watson could do that now. It would already know who you have a relationship with, because it would already be scamming your social media, totally. Because Watson is doing that right this second. Watson already knows that about you. People are buying that information from Watson about you. Watson is the most advanced AI, that at least that we know of publicly, in the world right now. It is the computer that initially was the project to attempt to defeat a human being in competition in the game show Jeopardy. And in 2011, like January or February of 2011, Watson beat Ken Jennings, who was to that point the epic, all-time, nobody's ever played Jeopardy like Ken Jennings, grand champion of the game show's history. And 7 or 8 months later, I met Ken Jennings and talked to Ken Jennings about that, and in the same morning, talked to the creators, to the team that created Watson from IBM. And heard Ken Jennings describe what it felt like to be playing against a computer, and then heard these people say what their strategy was for causing Watson to, quote, learn what needed to be learned, using machine learning, deep learning, mining the web, and having to have some kind of algorithm to know what to do with that data for fuzzy kinds of questions that definitely aren't math. Sometimes they're general knowledge, and sometimes they have a pun involved, you know, they involve humor, and sarcasm and idioms, and they don't spoon feed the thing. They choose the questions exactly as they would in the case of two human contestants. So at this point, I went in 2000. Was it this last year or the year before? I'm getting confused. 2015 August, I went to Mountain View, and there was a conference, a day long conference that IBM put on, where they had the people who were currently responsible to be moving Watson's agenda forward and commercializing what Watson was doing, and they had big bandwidth pipes in the building so that every one of us could get terminal time with Watson. And they had people there to show us how to do things. And we could come up with a kind of a meta search on a topic. And there was programmers there to help us to put it in, like, in moments that were really good, and we could ask to have, like, graphically, to have some sort of representation that would make sense of who else was looking at the moment, who else was looking at that topic in the world, you know, put it on a map. I mean, and happened in real time. And that's something that I conceived of, and they did on my request, which blew my mind. I mean, try that just with your Google search engine, you know. And then just, and then I could say, okay, I don't want to see what's happening right now. I want to see what's been happening for the last month. I want to know what's trending. You know, you and I can pick a topic. And so I want to see where in the world that's concentrated, or where in California that's concentrated. Whatever. I mean, it's just outrageous the way it can generate reports from data you'd never anticipate anybody would want analysis of. What they're demonstrating with it also is their ongoing attempt to establish some sort of sentience. So when we get sentience, like there's sense about it, like it thinks, like you and I, or looks to us like it does, when that happens, so, I mean, there may come a time where we can get, you know, in 20 years, we can sort of get off-the-shelf products at Fry's Electronics or off of Amazon and put stuff together at the kitchen table and be tweaking different ramifications, you know, different iterations of sentient robots at home. I mean, that seems far-flung right this second, but right now people are building robots at home at the kitchen table at this moment, you know, even within a few miles of here. People are right now sitting at their kitchen table building robots that you can order any componentry that you want, relatively inexpensively, from catalogs online. Those overnight stuff, you know, bustle wires and things like that, servos of various kinds and all kinds of wireless devices and whatever chips, you know, and you use Arduino, you know, and there's fourth and fifth graders doing it. Those are the people you're going to work for. While there are jobs, I mean, as long as the jobs last, you start out working for them, and then they won't need you because they'll make a machine to do a better job at whatever it is you and I thought we could do and prepared to do. That's going to happen fast. When it comes to that point, we can make sentient things like that. When I can make a robot at home smarter than my son and smarter than my daughter, then the line is going to get kind of blurry. Then we kind of are demonstrating that even if it's been latent, there's some way that we're within God's image that has not usually shown itself. Yes? Well, let's just say, for instance, let's pretend that you come from a family. I know this is not to be the case, but let's say you come from a family that has, you know, $300 billion in the bank. You've got a trust fund set up so that every day, no matter how stupidly you spent yesterday, there's $1 million that shows up in an account. And if you deplete it, it goes back up to $1 million. You have no credit. You can't borrow, so you can't even hurt your future. You just get $1 million a day. Whatever you want to do, that's it. Then what would you do? How would you spend Friday, this Friday, tomorrow? How would you spend tomorrow? You'd get on a plane and travel somewhere. I'm going to make a really bold statement. I want you to be careful with this. I want you to think really carefully and not use a lack of wisdom on this. But ultimately, however you would answer that question about what you would do if you had unlimited cash and if you weren't thinking about having to work or anything like that, careful not to misunderstand this. I don't mean this in a way that saws off the limb that you sit on, but in how you construct the tree that you live in. You're not going to have a decent life unless you actually do each day what you would do if you had all the money in the world. There's people that are from the same community that you're from. They're right this minute. They don't have a dime. But they're not in the country. They just got on a plane and went somewhere exciting to just go learn the language. I bet you can think of an example, can't you? We probably have the same person in mind, don't we? Always going to one other place to learn a... Does that person have any money? Heck no. Think the income of that family is really similar to the income in your family, right? Might even be identical. Somehow, whatever you would do if you have a magic wand and could just work it out, you should do that.
Getting back to the robot workers idea, if that was like happening right now, should we tax their labor or their income?
Oh, good one. People have been seeing that. Buffett thinks so. Warren Buffett thinks that we should. Here's the thing. I'm less concerned about that because it's such a short-term problem, the notion of taxes. Because by the time robots are actually able to replace all human functions in the workplace. I mean, what we're doing for work, I mean, what it is we at least think we're accomplishing by work. You wouldn't need to ever go to work if right now at home you had a replicator as big as, say, as big as a refrigerator. You had a replicator, or as big as a room of the house. If you had a replicator, big as a two-car garage at your home, so that you could basically make a picture in your mind and then just send it the way you push send on a text message or an email, and it would materialize in the garage. You'd go in, there it is, including making other replicators. Or vehicles, or anything you could imagine to eat, or gold, or clothes, or a fully charged battery at any voltage. If you had that device, the only reason you'd then go to work is you really wanted to do what you do at work. Can you imagine a job where you would say, I'd pay to do that? How about astronaut? Hey, if I got it in my wallet or my bank, you can have it if you let me work if you let me go to the space station, I will mortgage anything I ever earn for the rest of my forever. I will give you everything. If I could just get 6 months to actually have a project that they would want me to do in this International Space Station. Heck, if it was available, if there was a seat on a spaceship going to Mars that was one way, that only had enough plan to get there, do the mission for a couple weeks, and then run out of air, I'd go to be able to go to Mars, to be able to go into space. I'd go. What am I going to do? It could be half that important as a pioneering mission to Mars, no matter how much longer I live on this Earth with my current trajectory. What am I going to do that could add up in significance, impact on the good of our species and the universe, too? It's very unlikely that I'm going to do anything that adds up to that. So, I mean, by any stretch, I would go, I would text my family goodbye on the way to NASA. I'm there. So is there something, if I had a magic wand and I could wave it and it would give you a position and the skills to be the best there is at the thing, you would say, I will be getting up early, so early tomorrow, so I can go do that, if that's what I get to go do tomorrow. I don't care if they pay me. I just want to go do it. If there's nothing like that, after you get out of your whatever clinical depression you're in now, think about the question again. There's got to be something that you would love so much, even if the job is just video game tester. There's people who do this, actually get a six-digit income that are good enough with that, that are stinking, troubleshooting video games that nobody else has seen. There's people getting six-digit incomes to do that. So, I mean, any activity you can think of, it doesn't even have to be decent or legal. Somebody is making a lot of money doing it if they're the best in the world at doing it. I don't care what it is. I mean, no matter how unbelievably bizarre, somehow somebody has figured out how to make that a well-paying career. So what's going to happen is that the illustration of having the replicator where you can think things into existence and have it like made in the garage, that's absolutely what's going to happen. And when that happens, there will be no money. There will be no economy. The economy is over because there's no scarcity. And the economy is based 100% on scarcity because value is based on scarcity. Nothing ubiquitous is worth anything.
What does that mean for people who don't have enough food and water?
They'd have it. There'd be no such thing. There'd be no excuse. Because you can see a replicator can make another replicator. Right? We're printing houses. As I speak, there are printers that are right now printing houses. We're printing almost everything. We're printing replacement organs. Already. We're printing machine parts that they couldn't have existed because there was no way to mill such a thing before. Now, what we can imagine is, we're making things you couldn't make any other way.
I don't know much about this replicator, but what would supply the replicator, like matter?
Ambient matter.
Ambient matter?
Yeah, everything is made of the same subatomic parts.
So we wouldn't have to pay a supplier for it.
No supplier. Okay. Also, all around us is absolutely near infinite energy. It would all be local just from ambience. And if it needed a more concentrated amount, it's just put a spoonful of feces or dirt or something. It doesn't matter. It could be anything. Water, out of the toilet. It doesn't matter. It could be old beer cans. It is. But I think it's more likely to be able to just draw it out of the environment. We're not going to run out of Earth's crust or of like things we're tired of. They could just be disassembled and reassembled, just like that. But you don't have to wait until we get to that point to insist that how many people do you ever get a chance to be, by the way, each of you? You. How many people do you ever get a chance to be? How many individuals are you going to be able to be? It's not hard math. It's like the primary math. It's like some kids don't even walk straight yet when they get this, they can count this high. Just you, just one. Just one. And are there people who live their dreams? Are there people who are, they're going, they think of it, and they go, well, that's what I'm doing, and they go do it. What do you think when you see people like that? Well, that's fine for them, that's their them, and I'm me. And what are you? Are you the crap? You the leftovers of the species? What are you? What's with you so that you would look at somebody else doing that, knowing that they exist, even bump into them now and then and go, well, I couldn't do that. What is it? I mean, there's nobody here I see that was born, like, without a brain. You know, like, some people are born with just, like, a brain stem, and they don't actually have a telencephalon. But you're not like that. Here's another really bold statement. We have what we want. We already have what we want. I don't have a car, I want a car. If you wanted it badly enough, you'd have it.
So I know.
People work hard for what they want.
Yeah, I feel like if you're going to do something, like, you'll push yourself to do it. And
yes.
Some people say, no, I can't do it because I'm not as strong as that other person. So in that sense,
like what?
Like, oh, I can't get that grade. But it's like, can you? Like, if you really do try, like, you can get that grade. But, like, sometimes we, like, dumb ourselves down to, like, the point that, like, we just compare ourselves.
I didn't hear that.
I said self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah. I mean, can you pass it back? Thanks. I don't actually think that most of us think of ourselves as the subject of our sentence. I think we think we're serving a sentence and we're the direct object. But it's unnecessary to live like that. To be able to press pause and freeze the image and step back and look at our own screen, that's a tough deal. But that's what Socrates meant when he said, know thyself. What I'm driving at is that this is philosophy's project. You get old and then you still don't know yourself. You never really looked at it. I mean, and like almost everybody who meets you can see more accurately about you than you can see about yourself. And when that's the case, when you're not error checking, and you kind of have these little, I would kind of like to have that, I kind of like to have that. Well, not as much as what you have, because you're holding on to exactly what you have. I'm going to promise you this notion of, like, going to Europe. If you go to Europe, there's probably some cool things there. Probably none of them are any cooler than the things in California. I mean, seriously, they probably aren't. I doubt that Europe has anything cooler than Yosemite and Death Valley and the Pacific Ocean and Tahoe. I mean, what in the world? We're here. We're in the Napa Valley. This is where people in Europe dream of coming. We're already here. So, I mean, all it is that grass greener thing. It's the 10th commandment. Sin makes us irrational. Sin makes us insane. It's an insanity. It's mental illness. It's soul illness. We don't make any sense. When we're full of sin, we don't make any sense. When our operating system is programmed with the sin virus, we don't make any sense. We talked last time about how there was, according to the great controversy model. Now I want to say that is an explanation. There are other explanations. I've looked at dozens of other explanations. So far, this one seems like the most probable to me. But I can't believe that I'm going to get to where I can back away from our whole realm and see more, in the afterlife, after Jesus comes, whatever gives me a vantage point, or if I could just be given another dimension, I could look down at this silly me. I don't believe that the model that I have found is somehow going to be, that's all there is to it. That seems preposterous to me. And there's things about it that don't even make sense. That couldn't even make sense. Like logic and quantum mechanics and relativity and Newtonian physics. We know there's more because it doesn't make sense what we have when we put it together. We can't even put it together. Same thing with our model. So this is a model that I found that's the best model so far. But I'm not kidding myself thinking, no, this is it. There's no reason to think it would be more complex in the mind of God, because my mind is just as sophisticated as God's. Oh, how ridiculous. Not a God I want to worship. Trust me. If you find that God his elevator only goes as far up in a building as mine, don't worship him. Find a new plan. Do something else. But don't worship any entity that can't do an infinite number of times better than I can do, or you would be really, you'd be stupid. See, here's what I think sin is. You get created a certain way, like we're talking about. We're created in a certain essence. We're not a finch, and we're not a bass. We're also not a microbe. We're what we are. Now I could watch eagles flying and be all unhappy because I'm not an eagle. And I could say, how is that fair? Eagle gets to fly and I don't get to fly. Or I can say, Why do I have to be, why do I have to be born here in the United States, and I have to be born poor when I even went to school with some people whose folks had all kinds of resources that my folks never wouldn't even be allowed to borrow. And I could say, why is it that I'm not suited to be an astronaut, when somebody else is? It could have been an Apollo astronaut, and that would, be a legend and walk on the moon and all of that, would write my daughter's initials on the moon, like the last guy that walked on the moon literally did his daughter's name in moon dust, and it's still there. That's cool. When you come back and you tell your kid, I wrote your name, right on the ground, yeah. And it wasn't at the beach, it was on the moon, man. But the idea is that the notion of looking out for me as my priority instead of looking out for others is my priority. Like that story I told, my grandma dreaming she went to hell by mistake and then got taken to heaven and didn't look any different. Along with I'm looking out for me, you know. I'll get my own Christmas present so I don't get ties that are crap. I'll get the ties I like, and I don't get some Avon aftershave lotion that smells like toilet deodorizer or something. I'll go shopping for my own Christmas stuff, and then you go shopping for yours. We won't exchange, you know. And then we'll extend that to our whole lives. And I can live with having to give my own back rubs, I guess. It doesn't work all that well, but, you know, it works a little bit. Give me a tennis ball. I can, you know, roll around on a tennis ball. That'll do it. But there's more to it when you're looking out for self. If you see anything that you don't have that someone else does have, that becomes you don't get happy for them having it. You look and you go, what the heck? How come they got it and I don't have it? You don't go, oh, I'm so happy for them. You go, hey, no, seriously, how happy do you get? You go, oh, check it out. You tell your roommate, you know, hey, check it out, look. This is awesome. This guy won the lottery. Who cares? I mean, it is good news, right? But if the guy, like, took a bullet down at the college market and you were reading it in the Napa Register and had Herbie go, dude, look at this. Now, that's news. That's interesting. You know? It's kind of like, oh, sucks for him. Glad I wasn't there. Oh, maybe I could have been there to see it, but glad I didn't get shot in the head. But when it's something good that happens to somebody, unexpected, and that they didn't earn or anything like that, it's just good fortune, you don't go, ah, I was feeling all in down in the dumps, and now I feel so happy that they got that. And so anything you see someone else has that you don't have more of, you're going to feel bad about it. In fact, you start looking around, and whatever it is you got, you go, uh-huh. But look what he's got. I'm going over there. No, I'm here, but I'd rather go to Europe. I'm going to Europe. You know, now I'm in Europe. As soon as I get to Europe, it's like, you know, I would like to go to Nepal. I want to see the Himalayas, you know. Go to the Himalayas, you're going, it's really cold here. It would sure be nice if I was in Fiji. Fiji would really, that would do it. You know, one of those little floating cabana kind of lodge room things. You look out and it's like turquoise, you know. Go to Fiji, and you go to Fiji, and you're going, man, it never, so I'm not, I don't want to be here for Christmas, man, it's not even right, this is like August and December, get me out of here, I gotta be looking out the window and seeing some gray nastiness, or I can't open presents, you know, get me out of here. So no matter where you go, no matter what you have, no matter what you're like, if you say, you know, what, I wish I was like Arnold Schwarzenegger, you know, like, you know, the way he was, you know, when in a movie, Pumping Iron, you know, I could be like that, you know, so it's like, you put on a tight t-shirt and you go in and you're wearing your sport, you know, and people are going, whoa, can you imagine what it would be like to be so astronomically ripped that you just kind of, just by being there, people are not even able to think straight, they're going, man, look at his arms, man. Gee, you know, calves that are this big, that are like, you can hear them when they flex, you know. Or how about if you were the one who people were telling the Chuck Norris jokes about? Wouldn't that be cool? I just saw there was some insurance company ad that I just saw a link to on Facebook. There was two worn out looking old guys sitting having breakfast in a diner or something, and someone goes, ugh. One of the old dudes says, look, that's Chuck Norris. He goes, yeah, it is. He says, I wonder if he's still got it. I don't know. The guy takes a salt shaker. He goes, what is it? I'll bet you $100. I bet you $100 he doesn't still have it. I'll bet you $100. He'll catch this. Throws the salt shaker, and Chuck Norris jumps up and just like does a bicycle kick and hits the, or a sickle kick, and hits the salt shaker so that it goes right back and hits the guy that threw it right in the forehead, and then it lands right where it was. The guy says, "You lose." You didn't catch it. And they had been telling jokes too. They said, "Yeah, I heard that the boogeyman checks under his bed to make sure Chuck Norris isn't under there." What if you were so cool, or you know, you're a supermodel. You know, people pay you tens of thousands of dollars to put on their little semi bathing suit and walk around in big old heels on a runway. Go back and then you get your $10,000 and take your picture. You try not to fall off your shoes and everybody airbrushes the thing and passes it around and puts it inside their lockers and up on their wall, and you go, "Oh, I am so cool." So, I mean, these are things that, or you know, you wish you were Bill Gates. You know, he doesn't have to say anything all that important. You know, he can just say something. People, they make a meme out of it. You know, here's a 15-second clip of this guy saying, "Yeah, I think we should help children who are dying in other countries." Oh, it moves me to tears. Oh, so he said it. That, yeah, there's no one else saying that. You know, you get some nobody, and they say, "You know, I really think we should do more to help people." Oh, it's viral on Facebook. No, you don't mean anything to anybody. So we look at that and we go, "Well, what, you know, what am I? Just someone who also showed up and then nobody noticed, so I went away after 7 years. You know, just like a self-replicating poop factory gone tomorrow. What is this with me? I wish I was somebody else." And then you get somebody who's really somebody. You know, their parents got jillions of bucks, the Gates kids and everything. So let's just say you are, you know, the Bill Gates was your dad instead of whatever dad you got that did not make as much. I'll bet you nobody here's dad really manned up the way that Bill Gates did and stole that much money from everybody else. I'll bet you there's not one person here whose dad did business the way that Gates did business and, like, made an empire of tens of billions of dollars. Anybody? Am I missing somebody? Probably not. I probably would have heard about it. So let's just say that your dad was Bill Gates instead. Here you are with the last name Gates. So you go to school. And somebody comes and says, "Hey, how you doing? Let me be your friend. Now tell me what you're thinking about what they're thinking." Not genuine. Right. In fact, you could have billions of dollars, but all of the billions of dollars couldn't get you to know whether the people that said they love you would love you if you'd been someone else. Even if it had just been in the first place, if they'd have ever been attracted to be your friend or your lover or whatever. So I've met people that are super, super wealthy. And they're super, super lonely. So then they're going, "Why do I have to be born like this? Kid you not. I have an acronym. It's a backronym, okay? It's not where the word came from. It's a backronym. It goes the other way. It's for the word sin. Okay? I'm going to tell you what the acronym is in just a second. Here's why sin is, like, identical to being insane. It's a way to be crazy. No matter where I am, that's where I don't want to be. No matter who I am, that's exactly who I don't want to be. If I'm me, I want to be someone else that's different than the way I am. If I'm here, then I wish I was somewhere else. If I have the family I have, then I wish I had a different. If I have the car that I have, I wish I had a different car. If I have some abilities and lack others, I want the others. And the ones I had, they're not good enough. I want it at a different level, not this level. But if I had it at that other level, I'd either want it to be more or less, or of a different type. It doesn't matter. No matter what I have, it's a formula. You could write it out like a function. It's like x is what I have, not x. That's it. No matter what I have. Okay? X is what I have. X does not equal, I'm good with it. Think about that. It's a guaranteed unhappiness formula. You're never going to have joy as long as you have sin. Yes?
You have to actually have that formula taken out of your operating system. Your operating system would have to be modified, in essence. It would be a conversion process. It would be a conversion process. You would, and it happens different ways for different people. But it happens to almost no people. There are a few. They're called mystics. Saints and mystics. But all the rest, they're not happy. Oh, they might be, you know, they have some happiness. They're unsettled at some level. You know there's magazines today called Simplicity? Why is that? Because they already got more, and they're going, I can't choose between suicide and cocaine here. Here's a magazine that says, oh, you know what I could do? I could get rid of my crap. Then I'd be happy. Let's subscribe to that and consider it. I'm going to have less. I'm going to leave Wall Street. I worked my butt off to get I'm no longer going to do neurosurgery. I'm going to run a gift shop in Colorado Springs. I met a guy when I took my son for his 1 year well baby check at the pediatrician. Pediatrician is a guy who's maybe 4 or 5 years older than me at the time, very young to be in his own practice and everything. Owned the practice outright, thank you, Dad, in Lake Havasu City, Arizona. The only pediatrician in the whole county. And I take my kid there. And put him on a table, and the guy starts out by saying, you know what? I hate medicine. I said, are you the doctor here? Yeah. Today I am. Tomorrow I won't be. What are you talking about? Tomorrow you won't be. Lucky I got today's appointment. He said, yes, it is. This is my last day to practice medicine. What? He said, and I don't even know this guy. Talk about a professional demeanor there. You know, he slept through that part of med school, but he's like throwing caution to the wind. He says, I have always, and he said, there's only one thing I hate worse than medicine. I said, what? He said, little kids.
Oh.
You want to take your hands off my baby? And the dude, I said, so what are you going to do? He said, literally, he said, I sold this damn practice and I bought a gift shop in Colorado Springs. And I'm going to be there by the end of the weekend. I said, if you're not using that medical education, you mind leaving that behind? Someone else might want to use it, you know? I was like, you have got to be kidding me. Why don't you apply for another residency? I mean, there's so many ways to do medicine. I hate medicine. Why do you hate medicine? Oh, my dad was a pediatrician, and that's what they thought I should be. And I'm going, okay. You poor boy. It must have been terrible growing up with your dad as a pediatrician. And I said, I would have been just happy if my dad had been there. I would have been happy to have one. I wouldn't even have cared if he hadn't even worked. But your dad was there wrecking your life, providing
you know, and then paying your way through medical school and buying your practice clearly hates you. So I went away from that going, huh. Guy asked me, what do I do? I said, I'm the pastor of the Seventh-day Adventist Church here. He said,
why don't you come by?
Yeah, that's right. Well, he was going to be gone before Friday night sundown. And he said, man, you're so lucky. I said, I don't know if you have any idea what it meant for me to get through school starting with nothing. But I feel fortunate, but I do not feel lucky. I don't feel lucky at all. There was no luck about it. It was, I'm fortunate, but I'm not lucky. Sin, I have turned into an acronym. That's why I call it a backronym. And you're going to want to know this because I'm going to put it on your exam. Cue the screen.
He's writing on the board.
Since I'm not. Okay? I made that up. Since I'm not what? Whatever it is. Anything I'm not, that's what I want. That's sin. It's the formula to always be unhappy with your life, with your circumstances, with everything. Even if you like it, you don't like it that long. We're driven for it. Our neuropsychology sets us up to look for novelty, you know? You look at, you know, the Tiger Woods phenomenon. You don't have to look much further than Tiger Woods. All over the world, people are going, what? Kidding me? You did that? Yes, I did, and I destroyed my family. Yeah, I can see how you would be happy with a supermodel. You know, but you just want a little variety. Because it doesn't matter what you have or who you have. There's a lesson. If you enter into some monogamous arrangement with somebody, you need to know that there's more than one you. There's a you that's not that elevated. It's not that wholesome. That's going to just do the biological thing and go, oh, man, it's just like with shoes. I've had these for like a year and a half. Wear these all the time. It'll happen to you. And then you got to dig deep inside of you and find some other reason to be decent besides feeling like you did on your second date. Because you're not always going to feel like that. So when you make commitments, like whether it's your career or you promise somebody you're going to do something, it seemed like the best thing in the world at the time. You got to find some basis in your character, some sort of way to structure things so that, number one, you're careful about what you extend that other people are counting on. And number two, so that when you do decide to do that, you follow through with it. Otherwise, you leave a wake of hurt, and the world is a worse place because you came into it. If you'd like the world to be a better place because you came into it, you can't change up on people when they invest a lot in you. And that's a big deal in relationships. But sin is going to demand that you bail. I don't care who you end up with. It could be the person of your wildest dreams. Until they're the person you already got. Until you're used to them walking through the house in their sweats and farting. Or they don't know how to pick up what they put on the kitchen counter or the bathroom counter or what, you know, whatever. Or they make noise when you finally get to sleep. It's not just for
monogamous relationships either. This is true for your friends. You would be well advised not to just limit the serious friendships that have no romantic overtones, that just the friendships. You would be well advised to look at those, many of those, from a commitment basis also, and not just, well, I'm here now, I'll be friends with these people. When I go somewhere else, I'll be friends with those people. That gets empty pretty soon when you realize you don't have that many people around you that you share very much history with. Not a good way to live. Find some people and invest in those people and make it so that you go through and learn deeper things and make some history with people. Okay, and with your skill sets. There's nothing that you could want to do, no matter how talented you are, that there's not some gnarly phases of getting to additional levels of expertise. No matter what you're good at now, there's more you could do with whatever it is, no matter what it is. And it's going to actually mean things to you if you stay with it, whatever it is, long enough. You're going to get to where you get to where it's magic. It takes a long time to get to where anything starts getting into the good stuff. And it requires doing some stuff that isn't always titillating and hilarious and immediately joyous. Some stuff is hard work to get to the good stuff. It just is. Since I'm not, okay? If God knows everything, and God can see the future as it's going to be, number one, that doesn't mean predeterminism. You don't have to take away somebody else's freedom to act and make truly free choices just because you know what they're going to choose. Because it causes you to know it.
So you're saying it's like, maybe he sees two outcomes, like one route you're most likely to take and then maybe another
one? No, that's Rick Rice. Rick Rice, down from the Loma Linda area, wrote that book, The Openness of God. He goes with, God's a pretty good guesser. He knows, you know, pretty good statistician or whatever. He doesn't actually know. That's how he resolves it. Here's my take on that. That's better than, hope that wasn't mine. No, my keys are in this pocket. It was this pocket, did it? Let's find out. No.
Stops.
Yes. I'd hate to hear that and have it be mine. It's not. Whatever it is. When your inability to resolve some sort of complex issue in our four dimensions forces you to say, well, then I don't believe in God by definition. I'm going to change the definition. If God does not know the future, then God isn't there in the future. Because if God was there in the future and didn't know it, that would be interesting. The whole thing unravels. Ultimately, what you end up with is not a superlative, not an utterly other than. It's just the biggest kid on the block. Am I going to worship just the biggest kid on the block? If it's not utterly beyond it all, it's just somebody's bigger than I am. That's like people who swoon over celebrities when they come to town. That always makes me sick. That's pitiful. It's like an auctioneer. I'm watching for every little watching for every, I don't want to miss anybody. No, knowing what's going to happen doesn't make it happen. It isn't causal to just know. You leave somebody their freedom, but you can still know exactly what they're going to do. If I have a bulldog that hasn't eaten in 3 days, and I have a pound of hamburger right out of the package, and I put the dog and the burger both in the kitchen on the floor, and then I go out, let's be prophets. Yeah. Is the dog going to eat that meat?
Yeah.
The dog is going to eat the meat. Now, we're not that smart compared to knowing everything, you know, being omniscient. When you're omniscient, the complexity of the task, you can still, you got this. So basically, when you yield any of those things in the description of God, they'll all, you can unravel the rest. So ultimately what it is sort of a shell game to make it look like you still have something under it, but you got nothing under it. There's no God under there. That's an atheism. It's not really God. It's a minor deity, maybe, you know, like a Greek god, but it's not Zeus. It's just one of the little low boy gods, you know. It's not necessary to have it locked in so that you don't have true freedom just because somebody can figure out what it is. That dog has not got his freedom limited in even the slightest respect, but we know what's going to happen. I know what's going to happen. I knew. Oh, I just opened. Yes.
Have you seen the movie Arrival?
Maybe I have. Give me a hint.
It just came out in like November.
Tell me anything about it. Just set it. That won't do it.
On the cover of the poster for the movie, there's a huge stone.
I don't think I saw it.
Anyway, you should watch it because I felt like I watched it like.
Cool.
Like biblical, but it wasn't a Christian movie at all. But it made me feel like for a second I could understand a glimpse of what it must feel like to be God. And
Whoa, that's cool. Now I gotta see it. Arrival?
Yeah, it's called Arrival.
If I find out that I saw it and then I can't just put the name to the movie, I'm gonna think I'm silly.
I think you'd remember.
You think I'd remember? I probably would. I remember something. But if God could look ahead and see all of this hurt, we got another problem. Why would you go ahead and create when you know that by going ahead and creating, it's going to be this hurtful if you do it this way? I'm not even sure that PUC's IRB would approve that research.
I feel like he created us as being like the jury kind of thing.
The jury?
Yeah.
Well, how come we got to be the victim? Do victims get to also serve on their own jury? Because I can see the outcome. I don't know.
Without us, so he needed to.
Ah, that's interesting. Is it selfish? Maybe that's a silly question. But is it good? Would it be a good thing to look ahead and see the incredible hurt involved with man's inhumanity to man and accidents and exploitation and terror and bigotry and people buying and selling people and exploiting people because they're money, don't have enough money, or they're one color instead of another, they don't know the language, wherever it is they end up.
So it goes back to like the bigger picture of like God being in a different dimension, and so it's, you know, there's a bigger outcome from what we see in our small world.
Yeah. What if I could show you mathematically, potentially, that it was actually maybe actually good? What if I could come up with a mathematical way that we could all understand? I mean, not something that you have to be like Paul Ehrlich or Galileo or somebody to understand, but if I could just go to the board and do some math, and we could look at it and go, oh, so if I was God and I was faced with that decision and I wanted to do good instead of bad, instead of evil, I would go ahead and create it. Because that's a bad, you know. Would that help? If I could show it logically and mathematically? So I think I can at least propose one possibility. Okay. This is called the algebra of evil. That was cool. Was that out there? The algebra of evil. Cool. I need to get a TA that can beatbox.
Like a closing song for the summer.
Yeah, that's right. It's like the organist starts anticipating that I'm making it feel. Good. This is not the explanation. The only thing that this algebra of evil purports to do, the only thing that I would even claim that it even attempts, is to say, here is one example of something that could be. It's obviously oversimplified, but even at this level, if it was this way, I think most people would agree that the decision to go ahead and create, even knowing how much hurt there would be, would still be considered the right decision. Instead of, why not just not create and not have it hurt when you already know better. That's all this is. I'm not saying this is how it happened. This is not like out of the second book of Robert, you know, chapter 17, verse 3. It's not like that. Not out of Kurtz's Chronicles or anything else.
What about like before, like we were created, like heaven and earth?
That's where I'm going. That is, we're going back. Here's God. He hasn't created it. He's got a chance to say, no, there'd be so much pain there. Why do it? We haven't had anything like that. Why do it? Okay? This is going to require that we accept that one thing that most of us actually know, that we all actually, whether we admit it or not, we actually all subscribe to this value system. Okay? I think we all automatically actually share the value system that I'm about to explain. What we value is to hurt as little as possible, you know, to suffer as little as possible, have as little pain as possible, and to have as much good feeling, joy, pleasure, happiness, eudaimonia, the good stuff. Love, acceptance, and as little of the rejection and pain and hurt and nastiness and all of that as possible. I mean, it doesn't matter what vehicle you use to try to say that's your values. If it's religion, ultimately you believe that your religion is going to bring that about, that that's a vehicle to get to that. And if it's not, you know, if it's rationality and science or whatever, same thing. You believe that it can do a better job of making us not miserable and making us have pleasures and this sort of thing. Or you would end up valuing something more than that. Even truth, even when you value truth, we wire that in our heads to where we believe that if we have the truth, we get the material we need to not get tricked into having to suffer and losing out on some good stuff. We want to know the facts so that we can arrange things, have enough control with the real information so that we can set things up, get our ducks in a row, and our poop in a group so that we don't hurt any more than we have. So, let's say that God agrees with that. That God thinks that it's bad to have suffering and thinks it's good to have joy. That's not that big of a stretch, is it? If God was opposite, I don't know if I could worship that direction. Could you? God says, no, what's good is I want people to suffer a lot. No, I can't go there. So let's just say God values the most joy and the least yuck. Now, I don't know what the currency exchange would be between the two. But if I tell you right now, I'm going to stick a needle in your right glute, you're going to go, I'm not for that. I'm going to have to be against that for right now. And I say, because it's going to keep you from getting a lockjaw and you stepped on a rusty old nail that was in a horse stable. Now, I'm going to stick this needle in your right glute. You're going, okay, I'm not good with it, but I'm better with it than lockjaw. I don't want to lockjaw me. It draws all your muscles together and won't let you move until you die. You know, it's kind of a miserable death. There's some things where we'll take a little bit of, that's not good. Like, how about when you look at somebody and you go, this isn't working out. I got to break up with this person. I'm really used to him, though, and it's going to be painful, but this can't go. We can't keep this. You ever been there? You ever had to say, no, this is, I hate the idea we're going to have to break up. It's going to break our hearts, but no, we're not good for each other. You ever been? Friends that are there. So, you know, we mature a little bit as we get a little older. We say, our moms don't have to hold us down to get our immunizations. You know, we kind of put our arm out there or put our bottom up there and go, I know I need it. You know, it's like, it hurts so bad when you're going to get downward done and they put the needle up in there and go, you're going, ah, ah. And then they go, this will just pinch a little bit, you know. I'm going to pinch something a little bit. And it hurts like jamming a soldering iron up there, you know. It hurts like crazy. Not as bad as drilling into the pulp and into the nerve without it. Okay, give me a shot. Right? I mean, if they were working it and it started to hurt like a son of a gun, and you're going, make it hurt with a shot for a minute, right? So there's some sort of offset. I don't know if it's the same for everybody, but let's just say a little bit of not feeling good so that you can avoid a lot of not feeling good, you know. Okay. So if you get some great benefits also, it's like, can I punch you in the arm? No, you can't punch me in the arm if I give you a Ferrari. Yeah. You want to punch both? You want to punch me in the face? There's just some things. You know, if I said, can I cut off your little finger? just at the first joint. Cut off the little finger at the first joint. For $1 million. Any hands? Anybody would, for $1 million, say, okay. Yeah, okay, we got one.
me see your hands if $1 million would do it. $1 million. Hold them up high. We'll see how many we can get. What if it was $1 billion? Almost every hand would say you value that little part of your finger less than $1 billion. Hey, whatever. I won't play the piano, but I'll buy a pin.
Is there anesthetic?
So you know what I mean when I say there's a little offset somehow. Things can offset things. So here we go. We're going to set up the scales here. Okay, let's see. We're going to say, that's good. And that's bad. That's unhappy. That's yucky. That's miserable. Pain on the left. All the happy, good sensations. Everything goes on the right. Okay? Now, when God looks ahead, God says, if I go ahead and create, I can see that there's going to be a certain amount of hurt. It's going to exist. It's a lot. There's going to be a lot of hurt. There's thousands and thousands of years of a lot of hurt every year. Now, I don't know how much it is, but it's a real amount. And it starts with a certain, like the fall, or it starts with Lucifer getting conceited in his heart, whatever, and then it ends when Jesus comes back, millennium happens, come back with the new Jerusalem to the earth, and then lake of fire, and cleanse the earth, like completely like melt it down and redo Genesis 1. And then there's no more hurt, no more tears, no more suffering, no more estrangement, nothing that is unpleasant ever again. So it has a start and it has a stop, and there was a certain average rate. So it's finite. It doesn't go forever. Let's just say we don't know how much it is. It's huge, but it's X because we don't know what it is. Okay? So if God goes ahead and creates, okay? So the green is if God goes ahead and creates. And if God doesn't go ahead and create, can we get rid of this thing? See, we finally got rid of sin. There we go. Okay, so this is God's decision table. Not create. We're not going through with it. Too much. Okay, and here is yes. We'll go ahead and create. And yes, there will be some hurt and all that. Okay, so over here we have how much of this bad stuff and good over here. Okay, so we'll do on each side. We'll do the calculation. Okay, so if God goes ahead and creates, then there's going to be now. I don't know how. Again, I don't know how we do this. We'll say that J is the amount of like joy and pleasant stuff and all that, all the good stuff. We'll call it J, and we'll call this S for sin and sadness and sickness and suffering and all that. Okay. So, if we go ahead and create, then we have a certain amount of suffering that's going to happen, right? So we have S. S is a certain great big amount. I said before we're going to use X, but it's hard to remember what that one's going to be. So we're going to have a certain amount of suffering, and it's a lot. Okay, so here goes S in the bucket.
Okay, and S is a lot. I mean, we're not playing around. It's serious business. And then there's going to be also, though, a certain amount of joy, right? Do you ever have any joy? You ever have anything good happen to you? You ever have any pleasant feelings of acceptance and love and cheer and happiness and all of that? Just you know, there's a bunch. It's a lot. I don't know if it's more than this. I have no idea. We don't know what the values come out. But it's, you know, it's a lot. So there's whatever joy from the time that God creates. Here's, let's say, creation. And this is the timeline. Okay? And then here we go. It's the end of the world. End of world. Okay, and in here, you have a certain amount of S and a certain amount of J, right? So over here, if we don't create, we're going to say this is the same timeline. Okay? Well, you don't have any suffering. So S is zero, and J is zero. Nobody having joy. So you got the balance. You got S plus J, which are zero and zero, is zero. That's it. It's a draw. Nothing. Nothing. So over here, we don't know how big S is and J is, right up to here. However, they're not infinity. Okay? Suffering is not, does not go to infinity, and this joy does not equal infinity. All right? But afterwards, we don't know how many people are going to make it out of this alive, but a bunch are going to keep going. How long? Huh? Infinity. During that time, how much suffering will there be?
Zero.
So S sub 2, zero. How much joy will there be? J sub 2 is infinity. So I have to put over here whatever S is and J is, and then plus zero and plus infinity. So what I end up with is we can drop the plus zero, we get only S sub 1, which is finite. And here we get whatever J sub 1 plus J sub 2, which is infinity. And anything plus infinity is infinity. So what we have here is infinity. What we have here is not infinity. What we have here is zero. It stays balanced at nothing. And here, the result of going ahead and creating is infinity in the favor of joy. So what would you decide? Infinity joy, even after you take off whatever amount you have to for whatever time, you know, eons and eons later, you look and you go, that was bad. It was brief, but it was bad. But it was brief. And now this. And what would you end up with in infinity? Not a bunch of non-sentient robots. Not somebody that you said, oh, I'm not making them free like that because when you make them free, they go bad. But you would have freedom and all that joy without end in the system. So that's not the answer. It's a tiny little silly little cartoon answer. It's just to make the point that it's not actually valid. It's not right. It's inaccurate to say there's no way to explain it. Something as simple-minded as this could be. So it's invalid to say there's no way to explain that, and there's no way God could be good and go ahead and let all this stuff happen. Does it hand you anything? Anything to put another layer of consideration, at least? It's no slam dunk. It doesn't prove anything. But it keeps a proof from being valid. That's all it does. All it does is say, don't say there's no way to explain it, because there's a way. And this is probably a gross misinterpretation. But understand what the, because I'm going to ask you about it on the test. What it's intending to do is not explain to you what was going on in God's mind. It's just to point out that it's not valid to say there's no way to explain it. Got it? Everybody clear on what it does and what it doesn't do? If you're not clear, ask me now, because you're going to need to know for the test. Anybody who doesn't get that? Yes. This is not to explain what was going on and why God created. This is only, and it doesn't prove that, you know, the whole great controversy explanation definitely doesn't prove it. All it does is disprove the assertion that there's no way to explain it that makes any sense. And that's all that this is for. There's better ways, I'm sure. You all could come up with it if you just spent the weekend deliberating it. But it's supposed to just be simple enough to just go, well, there's that. If nothing else, there's that. That's all it is. And I call it the algebra of evil. Okay? The algebra of evil. Why would God go ahead and create when God could look ahead and see all the pain and suffering that was going to happen? Why go through with it? Doesn't make any sense. It's like if somebody told you, if you go ahead and have your kid's going to end up dying of cancer, you know, when they're 20 or whatever. That's the question is like that, you know, in that kind of category. That's not an easy thing to come up with, is it? But what if you knew your child was going to be developmentally disabled? You know, those are really hard. People have wrestled, philosophers have wrestled with whether or not philosophy provides us a way to answer one way or the other about whether there's a God. That's a huge issue in philosophy, and it goes all the way back to the earliest Greek philosophers, even in the Western tradition. Now, in most traditions, not in outside of the Western world, of course it's all about God or gods or the pantheon or what's out there. Ours is uncommonly sterilized of theology, more than others. Nevertheless, there are people right now that are on the cusp, that are very, very seriously, highly placed philosophers that are still going, man, some of the arguments might be inescapable. Some of the arguments are really, really hard to follow. If you want a real intellectual exercise, go on Wikipedia and look up Anselm's ontological arguments. You don't even have to say for the existence of God. You can just say Anselm's, A-N-S-L-E-M, Anselm's ontological arguments, and there are multiple versions that you'll find even on Wikipedia. And I guarantee you that will not be easy reading. To try to follow them, I don't care who you are, to try to actually follow the logic of it is it's hard. Now, Aquinas' watchmaker argument, you know, the whole argument of natural theology says, does the universe really look to you like something that happens by accident? Is this how things just go in this universe? Things, you know, just stuff just comes into existence and then it keeps getting more and more, you know, amazing until you have DNA.
Like I was just talking about Anselm, what's his main principle he's trying to get across? That God exists. He's starting out trying to show that God exists or to find out whether he does. If you would like to see, if you want me to do Anselm's ontological argument, I'll do it. We won't start it now because I need more than 5 minutes to do it. Trust me. And I will say this. Five or six of you will maybe be able to follow it. And I'm happy to do it on the board and all of that. And give you all the steps. Or I can give you a handout or put it up on the site or whatever you want. But I mean, this is like the Rubik's Cube that goes 12 wide. It's bad. It's tough. And if you can't handle multivariable calculus, any of you, I got little hope you're going to handle Anselm's ontological argument for God's existence. But I'll do it if you want. And some of you will go, that is the coolest thing I ever saw. Now, I actually think, when I look at it, there's a couple of questions that come to mind that make me go, unproven. I'm not buying it from that. Because there are ways you could, there are things you can say that when I hear it, I look at it and I say, I could just say this and then it wouldn't be the case, right? I mean, that's all it would take. And I think that's true even of like the watchmaker argument. However, that means, all that really means is I believe we can poke a hole in it and it's not watertight. All of these arguments are not watertight. There's something you could say so that there's still logical reasons that doubt still can exist with intellectual honesty. That's true of everything, even our own existence. I mean, we have to at some point say, I'll accept evidence, and then I know that my knowledge is never absolute. It's my belief, but I'm going to try to use sense, logic, and the evidence that's available to me or that I can gather. Like, there's nobody here that can show me, or you can't convince yourself, honestly, that you know for sure that you're not dreaming right now. There's nobody here that can come up with a way to make it so that you actually know for a fact that you're not dreaming right now. You could be in a dream right now. Everything that seems like this layer could be a dream. So given the fact that we can't even prove our existence, and that we can make a logical argument to show that we are virtual, we should be willing to accept some, you know, where's the weight of evidence on something? Okay, I think I'll believe that because the evidence is on that side. To me, when I look at the way the universe is put together, it really doesn't seem to me that if you let things just disorder themselves however they go, you know, just randomness, that you end up with elaborate, elegant programming in base pairs in the DNA molecule. Come on. We can't even program. There's nobody alive that can program like that. Oh, but, you know, that takes an accident. No, intelligence can't do it. Here's another thing. Take any atoms you want. Take your whole chemistry set. Lock yourself in the lab. Let me know when you have anything alive. There's nobody still who's come up with something that's alive from something that's not alive. I'm going to have a lot easier time entertaining with seriousness somebody saying, well, yeah, and then, you know, matter organizes itself, and then, you know, and then, of course, you know, just life is random. Okay, if that can happen by accident, you do it on purpose for me. But nobody has. Go ahead. Maybe we can. That still wouldn't prove that there's not a God that created it. But, I mean, I'd be... The fact that we can't even do it trying as hard as we can is like, I don't know about the just organizing itself part. I don't know. You can't even do it on purpose. And you tell me that's sort of inevitable that life just always finds a way. If we just find the right Goldilocks planet, surely it'll have life on it. I'll bet it won't. And if you sterilize it and came back, I bet it would stay sterilized. We have never won. How about this? They say it takes millions and millions of years. All right, take millions and millions and millions of little sample wells. Put all the stuff you need in there. Treat each one however you want. There you go. Just once, just the slightest little thing that we could call a, I'll settle for a virus. Put a billion little test tubes and we'll come back and check them, you know, in 10 years and tell me if any of them, you know? So I kind of think it looks natural to me, but I can disprove that. If anyone says that proves there's a God, no, it doesn't. Okay, guys, please, if you have presentations, please expect them on Tuesday. Okay? Well, most of them.
Thank you.